Okay, we can start.
I'm very happy to be able to talk to you today. Today my presentation is about my submitting paper. I'm going to divide my talk into five main parts. In the first part, I would like to talk about the reason after starting these studies. Secondly, I want to explain my RCT. And my sponsored trial, which is based on this analysis. Third, I will talk about the chance when result of RCT lead to this analysis. Fourth, the result of this analysis. Finally, I'd like to finish with a brief discussion. But first, and all of you may know, I want to talk about Japan briefly. I came from Japan in Far East. Professor Seti has been to Japan many times. Japan is an island country consisting of 6,000 islands or more around its main island. There are some cultural differences between the East and the West. The capital city, Tokyo, is located in cultural area of the East. I came from Osaka, the center of cultural sphere in the West. Osaka is aerially a very small city, but it's a metropolis that has a population of more than 8 million. About the medical care, there are 5 medical universities in Osaka. Kansai Medical University, where I belong to, was in charge of the Riverside area in Osaka. Kansai Medical University has 4 clinical units in this area. We have more than 1,400 hospital beds altogether. There are my colleagues in the Department of Psychiatry. The center of the, he is Kinoshita, the chief professor of Kansai Medical University. And beside him, he is Masaki Kato. He studied here before. Now, I will move on to the main section. As of 2014, 8 kinds of second-generation antipsychotics are available in Japan. In this compound, 3 are composed in Japan. How much evidence did each drug have? We searched it in PubMed. As a result, Ronacerin and Elstrom has a very little global evidence because 2 drugs are used only in Japan and Korea. However, Elstrom is sold from 2001 and has sales more than 300 million euro only in Japan by 2013. So, we thought it is a big problem that this drug was frequently used in Japan, but the evidence was insufficient. Therefore, our group planned our RCT of Elstrom. When we choose a control drug, we focus on a special trait of Elstrom. It is certainly 1A partial agonism of Elstrom. According to target of anxiety agents, such as Elstrom, it is reported that this receptor is related with improvement of anxiety and depression. The antipsychotics with similar effect have duloxetine, clozapine, and aripiprazole. We choose aripiprazole as control drug because we cannot use duloxetine and clozapine in Japan at that time. As a result, we compare the efficacy and durability. Elstrom as a full antagonist at ERD2 and aripiprazole as a partial agonist at ERD2. Both drugs have partial 13-1A agonism and 13-2A antagonism. This study was performed at Kansai Medical University from October 2006 to July 2011. This was 12-week randomized open label placebo study, and we recruited the patient met DSM-4-TR criteria for schizophrenia. Both patients with drug-naive and antipsychotics treated patients were incorporated in this study. For antipsychotics treated patients, switch was carried out mentioned here. Hypnotics and anticholinergic agents were allowed for emergency, but all other medication had to be stable at the study entry. Other psychotic medications were prohibited. Efficacy was evaluated in pulse, and EPS was evaluated in beats and bars. In addition, we evaluated laboratory data, ECG, body weight, and adverse events. For diagram, in total, 100 patients were randomly assigned to either pioglitazone or placebo. About discontinuation rate, there is no difference between each drug. This is the primary outcome of this RCT. Both groups demonstrated robust improvement from baseline to endpoint in PANSS total score. Between pioglitazone and placebo, mean change from baseline to endpoint did not demonstrate a significant difference in PANSS total score. After all, no significant difference of variability has been observed between two groups. The result of RCT showed that efficacy and variability of both drugs did not have a difference. However, the response of individual patients was not always the same. Some patients had remarkable improvement, but others did not improve at all. Why does this difference occur? Probably this is due to the individual factor. Since all antipsychotics target DLB2, the individual variation in efficacy is hypothesized to reflect the status of DLB2 syndrome. A theory, in the status of DLB2, DLB2 density may be associated with efficacy diarrhea. It is schematic view. If DLB2 density is low, a blockade with antipsychotics becomes easy, and the effect may strongly appear. On the other hand, if DLB2 density is high, enough occupation becomes difficult, and an effect of antipsychotics may not be given enough. What kind of factors are associated with a change of DLB2 density? Now, the well-known thing is these four. About sex difference, while some labels indicate difference in DLB2 density between the sexes, but others have not demonstrated any difference. About age, many studies have shown that the DLB2 density declines as age advances. Also, it is reported to be involved in polymorphism of DLB2, TARP1A and -141C insertion deletion are representative polymorphism. Furthermore, a more critical factor is antipsychotic medication history profile. This is confirmed in animal model, postmortem brain study, and PET study. Many factors are involved in DLB2 density in this way. Antipsychotic medication history profile is the factor which they can know easily in clinical care. And all clinicians know this difference affects the efficacy of each drug, each patient, on their own clinical experience. However, no clinical study focused on this factor have been conducted in a comprehensive manner. Here, we make two clinical queries and investigate it to solve. One, Is there a difference between drug money and antipsychotic medication in clinical response? 2. If there is a difference, is it confirmed in any antipsychotic? Front agonist or partial agonist? Of course, on the occasion of GIST analysis, we consider also the other factor which is related to DRP intensity as covariance. This is patient background. There were no differences in clinical demographic variable across group, except age and mean dose used drug at endpoint. The significant difference of age was found in between Prostrum AP group and Alprazole DM group. And the significant difference of dose was found in Prostrum groups. This is the result of transporter score as primary outcome. All groups demonstrated robust improvement from baseline to endpoint. Higher improvement was found in Prostrum DM group compared to Prostrum AP group. While other groups did not show difference in primary outcome after bone reduction. The trans positive and negative and general site pathology and excited component were analyzed as secondary outcome. Regarding the secondary outcome, Prostrum DM group showed higher improvement in trans positive and EC score than Prostrum AP group. Other groups did not show difference in secondary outcomes after bone marrow collection. There is no difference in trans negative and GP subscale improvement across groups. Now, adverse events. No difference in adverse event frequency was observed across groups. The most frequent adverse event was insomnia in all groups. Tolerability, DIPSS, breast total score, body weight, total cholesterol, triglyceride, glucose value, and QTC interval did not show differences. On the other hand, prolactin concentration was higher in prostaglandin DM group than each other group. However, using four groups as dependent variable in uncovered multivariate analysis, no difference in prolactin level was found after correction for longitudinal comparison. This is result summary. 1. Our notative finding was the evidence of better improvement in transposal positive and EC score in Prostrum group. That was DM compared to AP, while no difference between DM and AP was found in the Alprazole group. Regarding drug tolerability, the only difference that we found was higher production level increase in Prostrum DM group when compared to each of other groups. Discussion. In this section, I would like to focus on discussion of efficacy. In the interest of time, I will skip the detail of the discussion in priority. The results of this study indicate that previous antipsychotic treatment may negatively affect efficacy. When prostaglandin is prescribed as DRD2, the first clinical play as a hypothesis was good. So far, a small meta-analysis is performed about the prostaglandin efficacy. As a result, in pulse total and pulse positive, prostaglandin was inferior to other antipsychotics. However, after investigating the patient background of 5 studies used for this meta-analysis, about 80% of patients were treated with antipsychotics at least one or more. Considering this result, when we treated the black man patient, an evaluation for prostaglandin may change. On the other hand, this difference between black man and AP was not found in patients given partial eyes. Why was not the difference found in the eye color group? The detailed mechanism of the lack of difference is unclear. However, here is an interesting study reported in schizophrenia Britain in 2011. According to authors, placebo, clomipramine, or aripiprazole was continuously given to rats for 4 weeks, whereas the placebo group did not change for 4 weeks. But in clomipramine group, ERD severity increased to about 3 times. Furthermore, at 2 weeks, they switched administration from haloperidol to placebo for some haloperidol group. In the switching group, rise of ERD severity stopped. How about the aripiprazole group? The rise of ERD severity was not found in aripiprazole group from the beginning. At 2 weeks, they switched administration from haloperidol to aripiprazole for some haloperidol group. Interestingly, the ERD severity significantly decreased for haloperidol continuation group. These results show that aripiprazole may have the effect that reduced ERD severity. The last study suggests the possibility that aripiprazole reduced ERD density. But how about in the case of humans? It is not yet studied. If aripiprazole reduced ERD density in the human, how much time is necessary? For the lab, around 2 weeks were necessary. There is also not a clear answer about this. However, an investigation in Japan reported in 2012 includes interesting data. This figure shows onset time of apophysia and the frequency of it. 3,000 or more are investigated. The patients of around 70% received antipsychotics until just before aripiprazole initiation. Using aripiprazole for this patient, apophysia, which is commonly observed in PS in aripiprazole treatment, is found to begin at from 2 to 4 weeks. But in this view, there is a flip. When we pay attention to the close axis, we can find that each section is not uniform. 1 week, 1 week, 2 weeks, 7 weeks, and more. And that to say, probably onset of apophysia will be by model in the average, or on the average. In first 2 weeks, the group that apophysia appears may be low density group of ERD2 without treating antipsychotics. In from 2 weeks to 4 weeks, the group that apophysia start may be the patient that ERD2 density increased by previous antipsychotic treatment. They had decreased ERD2 density by aripiprazole, and apophysia might appear at this 2 weeks. If normalized of ERD density is performed at an early phase by aripiprazole, we may understand the fact that there is no difference between that mild group and antipsychotic treated group in aripiprazole group at our third week study. I talked about there have been a few studies that compared drug money with antipsychotic treatment. But in fact, there is one method in Aripazole. That study was a prospective, non-standard, single-group, 26-week open study of patients with schizophrenia in 2009 from Korea. In this study, a subgroup analysis, 80 group, is compared to the drug 9 group. But it is reported that drug 9 group was high improvement than 80 group in efficacy. However, between this study and our study have some major differences. At first, the number and period and those protocols are different. There are major differences in concomitant medication and statistics design. About concomitant medication, in our study, Phenotix was used for 48% and anticholinergic drug was used for 13% of patients. On the other hand, in this study, anti-anxiety agent was used for 85% and anticholinergic drug was used for 52% and mood stabilizer was used for 36%. Even antidepressants are used for 60% of patients. Furthermore, in the statistical analysis, we use a repeat measure and cohort, considering many confounding factors. By contrast, in this study, the confounding factors are not considered. And Wilcoxon ransom test was used to evaluate the mean change of arms at every time point. And they don't use the repeat measure. Therefore, a problem of not good comparison point. It's difficult to directly compare this study to our study from this point. On the whole, the difference of efficacy between drug 9 and 80 in first agonist may be smaller than that of two agonists. Conclusion. This is the first study to directly compare an ERB2 antagonist with a first agonist by patient and the psychotic medication history profile. Previous treatment with antipsychotics may negatively affect efficacy in treatment of ERB2 antagonists and may not affect efficacy in treatment of ERB2 partial agonists. That's all I have to say. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.